In that tone, we are truly, as we've always said, and we've tried to do, just talk openly, as we are all in this together. This is not one person's church. This is God's church that we're all part of. And we want all these congregational meetings just to be open discussions, where we're at, what we are doing. And I want to encourage that, too. We've got a few things to talk about specifically with some budgets and some finances for the next 12 months. But we really want this to be open discussion. You know, I've got a mic, but we got plenty of wireless mics now, and we will pass them around, make sure we get comments out, questions out, and make sure we're all on the same page. And as we start, though, so we're going to talk about here what we're going to go through real quick here in the next 30 to 45 minutes. It's kind of our basic agenda of what we're going to try to do. Looking at some of our, where we've been, what we've been celebrate, the goals, kind of our purpose, as I mentioned, some finances. We've also got some new board members now, as we are going for the next year, some new board members to talk about, and kind of the leaders for our church and what we're looking at. And then we'll have a closing prayer and move on. Okay. So I want to start out just talking about where we've been. And we did this kind of the last time we had a congregational meeting in August. But even though this is kind of December, as Craig hit on, everything in December, it all happens at once. We all talk about the year and where we've been. So when you start to look at this, and we talk about where we've been in 2018, that we don't want to forget that 11 months ago, we were still worshiping in the barn. Great space, great things we were doing there. We didn't even have a pastor at the beginning of 2018. When you stop to think about where we've come in just this calendar year, that we got that crazy guy, hands up in the air all the time. You know, we've had a retreat to talk about what we want to do, where God really wants to see us as a church going. We moved here to Prairie Hill. We were able to celebrate Easter. We've kicked off life groups. And it changes all the time, but we've got 70 to 80% of normal weekly attendees attending a life group as well as part of Prairie Bible Church, which is an awesome number that are getting involved. We're helping out with Matthew 25. We've started a nursery for those little ones that come to worship service on Sunday mornings. And we just want to remember that, all those things, as we talk about where Prairie Bible Church has been and where we're going. We move into just the summer months. I couldn't fit it all into one slide. But think about what we did this summer with our backyard Bible camp. We had over 20, 25 students, kids enjoy and learn about Jesus. We had our awesome potluck. We had last Tuesday coffee, a motorcycle ride. And I saved this picture from last time, too, because I think that's it. We're having fun, right? We're together. We're celebrating. Right. I mean, Lisa's famous, right? And it's a great picture. But it truly is. It's about, in all those different things, whether we're having a motorcycle ride or the last Tuesday coffee at Cava, or we're celebrating a potluck, we're being able to do it together, and we're doing it in God's terms and for what he wants. And that's been really fun. Now, then we look at what we've done since our last congregational meeting, and we wanted to hit on that and where we've been. And our fall kickoff at the barn was an awesome space. It really looks beautiful right there in that picture. I kind of remember how hot it was that day. Anybody else remember how hot it was? But it still didn't matter. I mean, we packed the barn. We had great times. We had songs. The kids, one of the things that I don't know if everyone even noticed from that day, but this picture on the bottom right is a lot of the kids, and they couldn't all fit in one bench. There was two or three benches with all the students and kids up front, which I thought was really awesome and exciting about what was going on. At that same place, again, we then shared the potluck. We had all kinds of food. In fact, I think there was more food that came left home. The wagon rides, even the blow-up toys for the kids, or maybe not for the kids. I was promised, and when Jolene showed me that picture, that it would never be seen by anyone else. I don't know how that showed up there. You have to talk to Lisa. Maybe she put it in there. But it is. It's truly just being fun together and having a great time. And that's what we want to talk about, is just the celebrations, where we're at. This fall, just in October, we've kicked off youth groups for our kids' age. These are pictures of mostly the middle, but getting involved with kids. And it's not just people from Prairie Bible Church. That's been really exciting. Not that we don't want to obviously include students from Prairie Bible Church, but there's a lot of students there. They've had 15 to 20 fourth through eighth graders and 10 to 15 ninth through 12th graders. We don't have that many students worshiping with us on a Sunday morning, but it's their friends. It's their neighbors, it's their classmates that they're inviting to come, to just be together, to hang out, to have fun, to go down the slides, to carve pumpkins. But it's also then about getting to know Jesus. And then when they're in school together, and they're sitting in the classrooms together, or they're out on the playground and somebody's being mean, now they've got somebody else that maybe has known Jesus too, and they can relate together and hopefully help each other out and support one another. And those are things that are just starting here at Prairie Bible Church, and we're so excited about. The Christmas boxes in the middle and the bottom, if you can see, those are the Operation Christmas Child that was talked about. And many of you and all of us kind of helped bring items in. To summarize that really quick, but it's a service that then those items, those toothbrushes and combs or pencils and papers and things, then are shipped all over the world and given to people that maybe don't have anything, and it's their little Christmas gift, and they treasure those things. What I think was really cool, and I don't know a lot of people understand, is each one of the students and the kids for that youth group, then they put a little note in there, personalized note, talking about how this is from Jesus, you know, that we're doing this for you because of Jesus' love. And the picture on the bottom right is they all circled up and prayed over the boxes. And they're learning about service, maybe more than what I know about service, but it's just sharing that. It's starting at a young age. And that's one of those things that we want to make sure everybody knows about and how we're all impacting. And let's not forget, it's not just the kids that are doing it. We've got adult life groups that are helping, that are gathered to just learn about Jesus, to talk about God and where we're supposed to be, but also serve. And these are wonderful pictures of areas that we're serving, whether it's making meals for people that need help in our own family that are sick or have a problem, whether it's providing gifts and opportunities for homeless shelters and things in the area, whether it's helping clean out gutters or fix siding. I mean, even the guys got involved in there, you know? I don't see the guys making any of the meals, but they were helping. I think it's important to just remember all those things that are happening just here in the last few months that we've really been able to kick off and that are happening really quick. As a wonderful reminder, we've got our general offering in the back with a miracle barn, and we said from the very beginning of Prairie Bible Church that 10% of every dollar that came in to our church, not, let me back up. Every cent that's given is all given for God. None of it is Prairie Bibles. And all we want to do is just try to use it in the way we can. And so as God has taught us to tithe 10%, every dollar that comes in, we will take 10% of that and then give, just as God has taught us, as a church as well. And here you can see some of that giving that's happened just in the last 12 months here in 2018. And we wanted to highlight, there's detailed information of exactly how many dollars. Some of these are categorized, like the local food pantries. That's kind of categorized. There's a sheet on the back table that's got every little line item of where it went, if you are interested to know where those went. But this gives you an idea of where the dollars are going and how we're trying to, again, as a full church, serve our communities. And realize that when you look through those, many of those are within this corridor area. That there's always been a concern from some people of where are we moving, and there's so many needs. There's so much concern here just in our local area. We want to be able to help. And this is a great example of how we are helping. Now, there's some things, the Jalingo Orphanage is in Africa, that we are taking some money and trying to distribute it internationally as well. And it's not just about here. God wants us to reach all people, but it's the way we're doing it. You can see it's giving of over 19,000 as of basically right now, because again, as offerings come in, we take 10% of that throughout the year, and we want to make sure we're continuing to do that. The picture, Jolene can help me, but this was for the food pantry down in North Liberty, right?
Right.
So again, that's just a way that we're helping and being able to serve in our communities. That's kind of the celebrations of where we've been. We want to talk about now as we're moving forward what our goals have been this quarter and what we're looking at for the next quarter. Any other thoughts on the celebrations? I mean, I don't think there's many questions with that, but I want to open it up if anybody had anything else that I've missed that we've done or been able to explore and serve in the last few months. Here, let's grab this. Is this on, you know? There you go.
Yeah, just one quick thing is, you know, at the beginning of the year, we decided to go ahead and invest in the web camera, which we put up, and we put the videos out, which typically get viewed on Facebook 300 to 400 times a week. Leanne Westcott has put together a great website, which we're keeping up to date. We've got Linda Waite does our Facebook, and then most recently we've got podcasts available so that people can listen in their car real easily. So I think we've really done a lot in terms of expanding our outreach to a lot of different people through social media.
You know, that's a good point too, Mark. Just maybe making sure we all know about that and how many people realize different ways that you can access it. You know, if you've got a friend or a coworker or something, they may want, you know, you may put on to them. You know, send them a link to the website. Send them a link to that podcast that they can listen and just know what's going on at Prairie Bible Church. It's a great point of what we're doing.
Maybe just one other thing. I'll give you all the challenges. If you use Facebook, just when you look at the video, should be up later tonight from today, just hit share, and that'll go out to all your friends. There's been a lot of people that I've talked with that first found out about us just by seeing it on the website. So, I mean, it's just a simple outreach that you can do by just hitting share or doing check-in this morning on Facebook.
Yeah, awesome. Okay, with that, last quarter, the administrative board basically put together three goals. We said, you know, these are our goals we want to try to work towards and kind of push towards. And we shared those back in August, I believe, when we looked at that. And that was to develop a worship leader plan and go out and recruit a full-time worship leader to join us here at Prairie Bible Church, to look at a capital campaign for where we're moving forward, and then an evangelism marketing plan and try to lay that out as we try to reach outside of our walls and encourage people outside of the community. So we want to just talk about some of those things and kind of give you an update where we're at, and then, again, maybe have a lot of dialogue and questions if you maybe have any. Craig's going to talk about worship leader as we get started.
I'll give you just a little bit of an update. We started, as Tom was suggesting, earlier this spring to find someone who would be our permanent, or someones who would be our permanent worship leaders. And we feel like we've been blessed with the opportunity to be a little picky and choosy, I guess, because Keith and Estelle are willing to work with us until we're able to find the person that God wants to step up and be our worship pastor. We went through the first round earlier this summer and fall. We got lots of interest, but not exactly the person that we're looking for. We started again this month looking or advertising and reaching out. We've been kind of doing it more subtly since last summer, but we started hitting it harder again just the last few weeks. And again, we've got some interest, but not exactly, at least not a whole lot of people that we're looking for, so that we feel like might be legitimate candidates. But again, I feel really encouraged because Keith and Estelle are willing to work with us as long as we need them, I think. And God does have that right person. So this is my challenge for you, that I want you to add as part of your daily prayers. If you've got a daily devotional life, I want you to be praying, not that God will bring us that person necessarily, but be praying for that person, because God's already got the person figured out. And be praying for them that God would bless them and their family, and in his perfect time and perfect way, he would bring them to our attention or us to their attention, and it'll happen exactly the way it's supposed to. Because I truly believe that God already knows what he's doing here, and it's going to be awesome. It's already awesome, but it's going to be awesome. So that's kind of where we're at. We're all feeling good about things, and like I said, we can be picky and choosy because we've got good people like Keith and Estelle with us right now. So,
awesome. Randy's going to share with us capital campaign ideas, thoughts, and progress.
Thanks, Tom.
Next slide.
So, this was a slide that Mark sent me, and it's just like, this is sort of our hope. This is what's an idea that could be out there. This is actually Billy Graham's library. And if you can see the outline of that, it's obviously in the shape of a barn, and it has lean-tos on each side, which is a dream we've had for a building we might have. So many of you have said, what kind of a building is it? I hope it could be a barn. And so we have that in mind. This is a little farther advanced than we might be. We'd hope to have lights in the barn. That's about all that's about all we could ask for. So anyway, that's a look at a dream and what we're shooting for in the capital campaign. Now, just before I go on, and thanks for this slide, Ryan, there's so many things that go into putting together simple meetings like this and reports and people that work behind the scenes all the time. And it's always dangerous to recognize a few people, but I'm going to live dangerously anyway. And I want to thank Mark and Tina and Tom and Megan for putting this program together and the PowerPoint and everything else that has to do with this particular program. And I see Lisa back there. I'm going to thank her for putting up with Craig. We sure appreciate that.
Amen.
But our true thanks to those folks for all they do behind the scenes. So many reports, figures, kept track of, thinking ahead, thinking outside of the box. So join me in thanking those four people I just mentioned, plus Lisa. So now to my appointed topic. We have a campaign, some many of you know this, called Pursuing Our Destiny. It's based on a sermon Pastor Craig gave back in June. And we've really had some blessings as a result of just starting to work with 10 different families or individuals and making presentations at 3 life groups. I have this piece of paper in my hand because at 71, the memory fades. So it's remind me, there's little packets back there about the campaign. If you'd like to pick those up, we'd be happy to have you have those. And it gives more details about the campaign, what our goals are, why we need a land and a building fund at this time. So far, we have total pledges and gifts of $272,500. $10,580 of that is in a savings account. And then you may remember back in April, the congregation authorized us to transfer $65,000 out of our checking account and put that into a savings, a time certificate, I would call it, for the building campaign. And that's now grown to $65,382. So total campaign to date, pledges and cash in, $337,882. Our goal is $500,000, so if you just take the difference there, the balance yet to be raised is $162,000. So we're off and running. We have some wonderful gifts already. We want to continue to talk to life groups and then other individuals, as well as just perhaps a mailing so everybody has a direct access to the figures and to our goal and what steps we might make. But we've been truly blessed. For those who've already participated, we thank you. For those of you who are thoughtfully and prayerfully considering participation, we thank you for that as well. The cool thing is, we're off and running. We've got a very nice total so far. But typically in fundraising, it's those last dollars that are the toughest ones. So your gift, whatever the size it may be, will be greatly appreciated, and you're going to help us get to that goal with God's blessing and, in fact, surpass it. Are there any questions about the campaign? Thank you so much.
Randy, that seems too easy. You sure there's no questions? We could pepper him with something, can't we?
Is there any news? I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Greg? Grab that mic. Give Randy that. Give him the mic, Mark.
Thank you. The question was, do we have a budget for that $500,000? And we're really kind of shooting in the dark because we're looking at a variety of things. Everything from bare land to, and we've looked at some buildings. Nothing so far has been a nice fit building-wise. The thing that the piece of property that we most covet, I guess I should say, it would be down at the end of Kirkwood Boulevard where it hits Wright Brothers. And the Krovanik family owns, I think, about 130 or 35 acres there. And we would love to get 5 to 10 acres there, but we have no idea what the cost may be. So we're kind of leaving this up to God to point us. In some ways, it's sort of crazy to have a campaign if you don't have a specific site or building, but in other ways, we feel like God has told us, if you read the document about Pursuing Our Destiny campaign and Craig's sermon, it's like God tells us to seek our destiny, don't just wait around for it to come to us. So we're on our way trying to find out what God's will is, and when he reveals that to us, we'll have some cash, hopefully, to follow through on either the purchase of a land or a building. Great question. Are there any others? Yes, we do. But if Tomas Trucking could give us a higher rate, we'd consider it.
And I think, Greg, a comment to your point of you just make sure everybody's comfortable. You know, $500,000, we get this. That doesn't mean that the administrative board or the leadership all of a sudden now has an allowance to go out and spend in any way. We won't do anything without everybody coming together and deciding where we use that money. But as Randy's point is, we've got that seed money that hopefully we could jump a little quicker as a family here when an opportunity presents itself.
Is there any updates on that Krovanik property that anybody heard? Or?
Yeah, so we have continued to talk with the Kovanics and the piece of land there. It's actually 136 acres. Again, so if you just go basically out here to the end of Kirkwood Boulevard, it has been sold, but it hasn't been closed on yet. And so what Kovanics have told us, because we've been in communication with them, is that they have mentioned to them that we'd be interested in putting a church there. It sounds like the developer is potentially interested in that, but they won't talk with us until it's closed. And it's supposed to be closed here at the end of this year or beginning of January. So at that point in time, you know, we'll kind of begin the discussions and just, like I say, see what cost it could potentially be.
Any other campaign questions before we let Randy sit down? And he mentioned, you know, we all feel sorry for Lisa Peters, but, I mean, Lisa Rummer has to put up with Randy, so we should give her a little congratulations for it too, right? That's right. With that, we'll move on. Pastor Craig has really worked on our evangelism marketing plan, so he wants to share a little bit about where that's at and as we start to unroll that. You've seen some of that with the sermon series, but...
Yeah, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time, but I just wanted you to know that we are working on a strategy with regards to evangelism and marketing. A couple of things, as you said, we did a survey of our area, which identified the number of people that we have, their station in life, their concerns. And one of the things that came out of this marketing information that we did was that there are a lot of people in our area right now. This probably doesn't come as a surprise to you, but there are a lot of people in our area that are just dealing with the overwhelming stressfulness of life, which is where our holiday season came from. And, you know, somebody had mentioned to me, like, how did you come up with the postcard to send out to everybody? It doesn't look very holiday-ish. And actually, it came directly from that marketing info that we did, that what are the concerns of people in our area within a five-mile radius of the school, basically, is what we were looking at. What are some of their major concerns? And we were able to discern that their concerns were just, how am I dealing with the stresses of life? How am I going to deal with the holidays? So today is a perfect example of it. You're seeing that. There's our plan, part of our strategy, that we will send out cards to our vicinity, our five-mile vicinity, a couple of different times a year, just to remind people that we're here. But we can't do it. We can't let our whole evangelism strategy be based in sending out a card once in a while. Basically, the statistics are that we get about 1% return on those cards, which is, that's pretty good. So if we're sending out 5,000 cards, if we get 50 people that have interest in Prairie Bible Church because of that, that's awesome during the season. But we can't let it depend on that. In fact, that's not even very biblical. We need to do everything that we can do as a church to reach out with the gospel of Jesus Christ or to encourage people. But one of the, probably the most biblical part of our strategy is we need to embrace, as a church, as individual Christians, we need to embrace our calling to share Jesus with the world. So part of our evangelism strategy is that during Easter next year, we're going to be doing, as part of our life groups and also a part of a sermon series, we're going to be doing a study called Just Walk Across the Room. And in essence, what it is equipping you with the knowledge, the skill, the ability to share Jesus with people at work or in your neighborhood or at a office Christmas party that you might go to. What are some ways that we as Christians can, in a gracious and loving way, share Christ with the world? That's probably the biggest fear that people have. I have no idea how to do this, or that just scares me. And we're going to demystify it. There's some very basic things, that tools that we can offer to you that will help you to share Christ with the world, with your world, and that's part of our strategy. So this is not random. We're trying to do what God's calling us to do.
And he's already sat down, but the question is there questions? You know, the things that you want to see, you know, why are we doing this? Why do we send those parse cards out? What are the things we want to be doing? You know, we want to make this a discussion.
Another perfect example, by the way. I should wait for questions, but one of the things we were able to tell from our marketing research is that most people in our area travel at least a half hour to and from work every day. That doesn't surprise you, does it? Well, that's where Mark got the idea to do the podcasts. So if people are traveling to and from work, just turn on that podcast and you can hear the message every week. So it's just offering those kind of different things that will help people to get the word out.
So the key is if you're distracted and kind of daydreaming during the service, then I can listen to you on Monday or Tuesday.
Yeah, I think that's exactly what I was trying to get at.
And we've talked about, for instance, if we have 50 new people come to Prairie Bible Church over the next month, at some point, the next services, I think even more important is if somehow they get here, whether they find us on the internet, they find us through a postcard, whatever the reason they find us, it's not important that they find us. More important is that they feel welcome and they want to come back. And I think I can say most people in the room right now are vested. We're all in this together. We're all family here at church. And so I want to just be open and have this discussion about we can't just enjoy being together on Sunday morning or individually. We've got to make sure that we're open our arms and our ears and our eyes to people that are coming in and try to make them feel comfortable. Because the biggest thing is we can get 50, we can get 100, shoot, if we get 500 people that come over the next month, but they only come once and that's it, doesn't matter. And I think that's a big thing that I'm hoping, I think a lot of us are hoping that we can all work together to reach out to someone, you see somebody that you don't know.
I laid a challenge before the administrative and ministry boards the other day, and the challenge was this. When you come to church, some of the people that have said when they come and experience us as a church, they go, you guys love one another, and that's a wonderful thing. But implicit in their statement was that they could tell y'all loved one another, but can I get in there and be loved too, was the question that they were really asking. So I laid this challenge before the administrative board and the ministry board, and I'm laying it before all of you now too, that as people who are invested in the mission and the vision of Prairie Bible Church, put on your God glasses when you come to church, on a Sunday morning especially, and if you're standing and having conversation with one another and you notice somebody that you don't know, which hopefully that happens every week, stop what you're doing. Give yourself permission to say, hey, I got to stop what I'm doing here. I got to go say hi to this person because I've never met them before. Because we want, just as Tom was saying, we want everyone to feel the same love as what y'all feel as part of Prairie Bible Church. And giving each other permission to say, hey, put that on hold for a second. I'm going over here to say hi. That's a big deal.
No other questions, we'll keep moving. I just want to make sure we open that up. Christmas schedule, we talked about it a little bit. I've mentioned it at service, so I won't hit on this a whole lot. We've got the December sermon series that Craig's working through. We talked about December 23rd is going to be a special Christmas program for the kids. And then the 24th, we're going to have Christmas Eve here. And I just put a picture up there of last year. I've had a lot of people ask me, you know, what are we going to do? We had Christmas Eve in the barn last year. We said that was awesome. It's a great experience. Nothing to say we can't do that again in the future, but we're trying to reach out to others. We're trying to hopefully get new people that want to come in. And maybe somebody's looking for a Christmas Eve space, and we're actually not even going to have Christmas Eve service here. We're going to have Christmas Eve service across the hall in the gym. And our hope and our prayer is we have to, because we can't fit everybody in this space. And the barn was cool. It was awesome. Everybody loved it. But we can't fit everybody up there. You know, and it's tough access. There's no heat. There's a lot of things that make it a real challenge. And we're really excited about inviting people, encouraging people, and we hope that we are busting at the seams and that we're thrilled that we're over in the gym and we got 300 people here on that Christmas Eve service at 5 o'clock. So we want to spread the word, make sure everybody knows. We'll have plenty of chairs. They got some bleachers we can roll out. We'll fit everybody in, and that's why we want to do that, and that's where our focus is. And that's what we're looking at for right now. Again, any questions with that or concerned with that, but that's our dream and our purpose for that. Okay? Let Mark run some finances and some numbers.
All right. Before we go on to that, I appreciate Randy mentioning the people that helped pull together today, but I wanted to do a shout out to him too. Many of you may not know that Randy actually has banking background and was a professional fundraiser for a few years. So the fact that, you know, a brand new church has kicked off a capital campaign pretty quietly, so it's not getting shoved down everybody's throats, and we're almost 70% of our goal in a couple months. It's pretty phenomenal. Randy's done a lot of great work, so give him a hand for that if you would. So next thing, I'm going to talk about two different things here. First off, just talk about where we're currently at from our finance standpoint, and then next talk about our proposed budget for 2019. So in terms of where we're at today, I mean, God's really blessed Prairie Bible, and we really thank you for all your generous giving throughout the year. And you can see where we're at here, and this is a snapshot from January through the end of November. The green line on top is what our current checking account balance is, and you can see that's continued to grow throughout the year. In our August meeting, we made the decision that we transfer $65,000 out of our checking account and put it into our building fund. So that's why you see it dipping down, but then you'll see that it's starting to climb back up again now. The blue line is our giving, and our giving has been real stable to slightly increasing throughout the year. So we're around, I think it's $3,773. I guess I got it up there, is what our average weekly giving is. So again, pretty phenomenal. And right now our projected year-end balance based on some mission distributions that'll occur in December, I think it'll be around $70,000. So before I go on, one of the feedback we got, and we appreciate feedback from the last congregational meeting, was, hey, spend more time, make sure that everybody gets their questions out. So does anybody have any questions on this? Yeah, as Tom said, there's actually financial information in the back that's QuickBooks that shows balance sheet and also a P&L. And I guess I should do a shout out here now to also to Larry Finner. Larry, you want to stand up for a second? He's relatively new to Prairie Bible, so many of you may not know. But this is another one of those God things, I think, because we kind of decided that, hey, we need to be running our payroll through a professional service versus just kind of Tina and I doing it. I just started going through the phone book, and I found different accounting companies, and it turns out that the third company I called to get quotes on doing our withholding was Larry. And as we talked a little bit, I said, well, let's set up some time. And so I called back into the office, and the secretary answered, and she said, well, Mark, you know who this is? And it was Joyce Saraway. So many of you probably know Joyce Saraway. She works for Larry. So long story short, Larry picked up the withholding, and then recently we decided we're going to kind of move all of the QuickBooks management over to Larry's company, A-Plus Accounting. And Larry has donated all that effort. He said it was one of those things that one of the sermons he heard here was, you know, use your time and talents, and he felt that was a great offering. So just appreciate that, Larry. Mm-hmm. All right, so this is one that you probably will have questions on. So this is a 2019 proposed budget. And so a couple things on this. A lot of this is kind of put in some larger categories. Again, we've got more detail on a handout in the back if you want to take a look at it. And the ad board went through this, and these are just kind of the areas that we believe bucketed. So it doesn't mean that we're committed to spending these dollars other than probably Craig's salary.
Thank you for that. I appreciate that.
But, you know, as we go through the year, we'll go ahead and believe that this is where we're being led to spend the dollars. So, I mean, I don't want to read through all of them, but, you know, right now for the giving side of things, what we did, we just decided to be conservative. So we said, let's just don't assume there's any growth in giving next year. Now, I believe there will be growth next year, but for the budget purposes, we said flat giving in terms of the general fund for 2019. So that's the 196 number at the top. Lead pastor salary, you know, the other salary pieces we've got there. As you go down, well, I guess I skipped the first one. Again, you know, right off the top is our 10% of all general fund giving goes to missions. So we've got that at the top of the budget. Probably a couple things there. You may have questions on the marketing. We've got just a $10,000 budget in there, which sounds like a lot of money. And we may not spend all that, and we're not sure exactly how we'll spend all that yet, but there's things like sending out postcards for next year's Christmas, next Easter. That's almost $2,000 a time when you send out that mass mailing. Looking at maybe doing more on social media, again, to try to get the word out, you know, God's word out, not just about Prairie Bible, but, you know, to really go forth. So that's one of the other areas. We also decided that we wanted to really focus more on youth in 2019. So we really just kicked off our programs here this fall, but we want to try to back it up with some additional spending and some additional resources. So there's dollars in there for that. So when you look down to the bottom, you know, you take your overall giving minus our expenses, that would mean that we're about flat, you know, $6,300. And then plus, we believe we'll have a $70,000 cushion coming into 2019. So that we believe the end of this year, we'll have that $70,000. That's obviously not in this 2019 budget. So a lot of information there, but I'd be happy to answer any questions you have.
Would you decipher the difference between the lead pastor salary and the worship pastor salary?
So the lead pastor is Craig, and the worship pastor, we've actually got a couple different things in there. So I've got some money in there for recruiting budget, and like I say, it's broken out in the sheet in the back. You can see the more of the details there. We actually rolled some of the guest preacher dollars into that when Craig's out on vacation, as well as covering Keith and Estelle until we find a full-time person, and then the full-time person. So that's what's, there's a bunch of things kind of in that category. Good question, though. Other questions?
Is that insurance, including insurance for us to be in this building, health insurance for the staff, or what does that include?
Yeah, that's a great question in terms of what the insurance covers. So right now, Pastor Craig does not have, or none of our personnel have any health insurance. So that's not part of the package we offered. So that insurance is a couple different pieces.
It's Mark, can I pause for just a second? Lisa and I do have health insurance, okay? But it's not offered. That is how we're paying for it, is coming out of that $90,000. So that $90,000 is the overall package of everything that it costs to have us. But so out of that money, we're using that to get our health insurance. So I just want to make sure that people didn't think we were without health insurance.
Yes,
that's good. Yeah, that's right. So that includes everything from, I mean, like if we were to use this from a previous denomination, there would be things in there from health insurance to pensions to, you know, all that whole thing, housing, all that stuff. That's what that $90,000 includes. So that's a really good question.
And then just to finish up on that, so the insurance is for insurance on this. We also have, there's a bunch of different riders that are put on for just a safe sanctuary type of things in terms of if we get sued by anybody for whatever reason, it'll cover it. We actually have coverage on where the ad board meets at in the Exchange State, the old Exchange State Bank. So there's a few different things that are incorporated that. And then our rent, we're really blessed. The rent is only $85 a week in this building. So that's what's taken there across the 52 weeks.
Other questions? I'll just hand a mic.
That's their salary? Is that what you're kind of figuring?
Yeah, so the worship pastor, again, you know, we talked in the last congregational meeting is that we had budgeted $30,000 for the worship pastor salary. Now, obviously, we're not going to be starting on January 1st, so we don't have it. So it's now kind of broken up in a couple different categories. And, you know, it's been, I know there's a lot of questions afterwards. Well, why do we need to pay, you know, worship pastor $30,000? And I think we've already proved that $30,000 is going to be difficult to find the caliber of people we're looking for. So, you know, we're looking for more than just a song leader. And there actually obviously is a lot of prep involved in different things. But, you know, we're continuing to look to see if we can find somebody like Keith and Estelle for $30,000. And we've advertised, nationwide so far. And it's tough because at $30,000, you know, nobody's going to come move to Cedar Rapids if that's their only job. So, you know, we're kind of in a gray area, but we're really looking for, you know, a professional people that can help grow and build us.
So just so if I'm looking, because I've got a few things in mind for some people we know, basically what would they be in charge of? Sunday mornings like Keith and Estelle do, and that's about?
That's a really good question. What we're asking of Keith and Estelle aren't paid the salary that we're offering this next person. So what happens on Sunday mornings, preparation for that, working with to develop our music ministry in general. And then also, the assumption would be that they're going to be a part of the leadership and the life of Prairie Bible Church. Keith and Estelle kind of aren't. I mean, they're Catholics, and they're very committed to their Catholic faith. So they're being a blessing to us. We're asking this person to become part of our leadership, become if they have other areas of interest or gifts and graces that they might be bringing to us that develop that. For example, one of the things you may have noticed up here in the youth and children's ministries, building into that is we want to launch into the Kirkwood Community College area. And one of the things that's a possibility, depending on whether this person has interest or ability in it, was that would they help us in reaching that community? Depends on who they are, if they have the ability or whatever. But that's a possibility that I have in the back of my head as we're interviewing people. Maybe they have some interest in that. So much of it is developing, and it depends on the people that God brings to us. But primarily, it is the development of our worship ministry and all that stuff that comes along with it. Does that help answer your question? Okay, good.
That's just like a starting wage.
It really is. I mean, hopefully, you know, as we continue to grow, you know, that we're assuming that really this $25,000-$30,000, we're thinking 20 to 30 hours a week is what we're... Exactly. It's a part-time job, and then we would grow into it. Yep.
Does Kirkwood Community College know the music department?
That's a really good question.
You want to repeat that question?
She asked, does the Kirkwood Community College, does that community know that we've got this out there? We've actually reached out to most of the college, like placement centers, to let them know that this is what we're looking for. We've actually reached out to lots and lots of different places and people and locally. Yep. And we thought maybe that would be a good, we'd get a lot, we haven't got anything from Kirkwood, University of Iowa, so.
Doesn't mean we won't.
Doesn't mean we won't, we just haven't yet, yep.
Other questions, thoughts, comments? Yeah.
Okay, so. You know, reaching out to everybody, I think is really important. But I know when we get to our goal is, and I think Randy might have talked about it at our small group, are we more apt to get a loan from a bank so maybe we can build sooner than later? Because I feel like that will bring more people in also. I mean, we all like it here, we're fine. But as a new person, I think it would be helpful.
Randy, you want to? He's got the relationship with the bank, just talking about what a bank's potential to loan us money would be.
Well, the answer to that question is part of the reason we want to get that $500,000 together is because it would help us get a bank loan. Our accounts are at Hills Bank. We had a lunch with them several months ago, and they talked to us about the possible need for a loan, and I don't remember the exact terms, but that was very lucrative, and they are currently financing 13 other churches in the area, so they definitely know church finance, and they would be ready to loan to us, particularly if we get to that $500,000. Obviously, if we didn't get there, it'd just be a multiple of where we're at now, or, you know, I have every confidence we'll make 500, but yes, we do have financing available to us. I should have mentioned, too, I was having fun with Emil about in the investment of that $65,000, but it is in a time certificate. The rate is 2.35%. It's a 19-month certificate, and because we didn't know how long we might want it, the bank has given us the right to pull the money out of the time certificate any time without any penalty and any forfeit of the interest. So they've really gone over backwards to help us a lot with that.
Great point. Any other questions?
Okay. Then, do you have a question, Nick? No, you're just stand up stretching. Okay. All right. Then we'll move along then. And again, there's handouts in the back. If you've got any questions about the budget, feel free to, you know, give myself or anybody on the board question. So I just wanted to spend just a second here on the admin, the ministry board. So this is something that we set up kind of right from our initial start that's different than a lot of churches there, where we've really got the admin board is in charge of kind of the financial pieces, the operational piece of the church, personnel side of things. We typically meet twice a month, and you know, to keep things moving forward. The ministry board is strictly focused around, you know, the ministry areas of the church, including youth. The missions is a big piece, so they help not only, you know, drive new mission areas, but decide how the mission dollars will be allocated. So if everybody that's on the admin board first, if you guys want to stand up. We've got a few here, all right. And then next, the ministry board, the people that are here. If you guys could just give them a big round of applause, because you're worth of great work. So I've got a couple stars here, and on the stars, those are people that are going to be rotating off at the end of the year here. So they've done a great job.
I failed to get this word to you, but Linda, my friend Linda, I don't know if you've have met her or not, but she's that one that she's real quiet. She sits back there a lot. Linda Wade is going to be rotating off too in this class.
Okay, all right. And so those people that are rotating off, again, we really appreciate their focus and effort in growing us over the last year. So I want to talk just a moment just about the board process. So when we originally set up last year, you know, what we said is the normal board term is 3 years. And what we just recently determined the ad board is, hey, let's ensure that we've got 9 people on each one of the boards. And then so each year we would rotate 3 people off and 3 new people on. That way we keep fresh ideas coming in and give people an opportunity. So, and then we'll go ahead and do like we did this year again, where we'll do November, either going to be self-nominations or somebody else can nominate. Craig usually has a meeting with the people just to make sure that they understand kind of the roles and responsibilities. And then at the congregational meeting here in December, then we'll go ahead and elect those new members. So any questions on that before we move on to the next step here? All right. So here are the people that will be are on our slate for 2019 starting. And maybe, Ron, if you could start off first and stand up so people see. And you don't have to, like, say anything, or, you know, we could have you do a little dance or skit or something, but we'll keep things moving. Linda Anderson, I don't know if Linda was here.
Yeah, I don't think Deb or Linda are here this morning. So.
And then on the ministry board, Shane, I know Shane's here.
Yep.
And Rod Ross. All right. If you guys give them a hand for volunteering to be on the board.
I just have one, because I wasn't sure about Linda when we were putting this together, but because we want to have 9 people on each board, there is an opening yet for the ministry board. And as Mark suggested a moment ago, that ministry board that's the board that where we focus primarily on programs. Missions and worship and children and youth and supporting them. We don't do those ministries specifically, but we support and encourage them. So if that's something in particular you feel God's calling, we can operate with 8 people. We've been doing that all year. So it's not absolute necessary, but if that's something that you have a calling in your heart to do, let me know and we'll talk.
So next we're going to, I think Tina and a few other people, if they can hand out voting slips. And on the voting slip, it has, you know, do you agree with the proposed budget that you saw up here and agree with these board nominees? And you can just circle yes or no on that. And while you're doing that and we're counting the ballots, I think we're ready for a video. Bring up the PC, Ryan.
Everybody has trials and temptations. Everybody knows heartbreak, isolation. But we can lay our burdens down. Forever.
Everybody has fears. Everybody got worries. Everybody knows sorrow, devastation.
Anybody have a ballot? You get? I'll grab them. Thank you. Thank you. Any others? Okay, our hope was that the song was just long enough to count the ballots. If not, I need to get Sarah up here to sing and dance because you don't want to watch me do it.
Yeah, we do.
No, you don't. No, definitely don't. Ryan, maybe we should play the video again. Oh, Shannon, you got a question? You want to, Mike? Yell. Great question. Good filler. Thank you.
Question was... Okay, good. We had a question about baptism and about membership. Let's start with membership. Membership, we administrative board is identifying three quarterly goals, all right? And so my guess is, though we haven't set a quarterly goal for the first part of 2019, is that membership, we have been working on membership standards and what that might look like, so it's not like we're starting from scratch, but we will take the information that we have that we've put together for membership standards, discuss it as administrative board during our quarter, during that first quarter of 2019, and then it could happen if, you know, as we do our, we're going to do our quarterly meeting, so it could happen maybe in March where we would come back to the congregational meeting with our membership standards and, you know, establish them that night or that day. And we could even have a great Sunday right after that where we have a membership Sunday and it's just a great big celebration where we receive 150 people on one Sunday. Wouldn't that be awesome? Yeah. Yeah, generally what we would do, if you have your membership at another church, basically what you would do is just let them know that you're transferring your membership to Prairie Bible Church, and they may say, okay, that's fine, or they may send you a letter saying, you know, that you've been transferred or whatever. However they want to handle it is totally fine, and they may not do anything. They may just say, you know. But... I haven't answered Shannon's question. Shannon's question was, what about baptism?
We're going to wait for a day when it's raining. We'll go outside.
That is something that I have my own personal opinions on, but we haven't spent any time, as far as I know, from an administrative board perspective, about the theology of baptism and how we or what we believe at Prairie Bible Church with regards to baptism. I guess that's something that we could probably and probably should be put on our quarterly goals too. Because like I said, I haven't given as much thought to that as I have to the membership thing. So Shannon, and I would say this to Shannon and to everybody else, if you guys have thoughts, questions, beliefs that you would want us to consider and prayerfully live into, I'd like to hear what those things are. Like I said, I have my own. And it'd be very interesting to hear everybody's that is interested in seeing what that looks like and as we move forward. So that's a good question. Thank you for spurring that conversation.
Any other questions? I think we've got a vote tally.
Well, Don, as the official secretary, can give us the vote tally, but you got to talk into the microphone, Don. So.
Here. Well, he needs it on the video. There you go.
I don't like these things. They intimidate. We had a unanimous yes for both.
Awesome.
All right. I think that concludes it for today. Pastor, you want to just close us out in a prayer?
Let's do. Lord Jesus, I praise you and I thank you for my church, for your church, for Prairie Bible Church and the privilege that we have to be your body to this world. It looks unique through us. What our calling is, what our mission is unique as to what you're calling us to be, how you're calling us to be, your hands and your feet, your eyes, your ears, your voice to the world. And I thank you for the privilege. Part of our uniqueness is that we live into being simple and authentic, a simple and authentic representation of your love to the world. And may we never forget that. Every time we as human beings might throw ourselves into the complexities of religion, may we remember to embrace our calling. And because really, ultimately, it's all about you. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.